Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, my dear brothers and sisters, we have had a very good khutbah from our brother, Brother Abdul Rahman, our Imam here. MashaAllah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and bless his family. Jazakallahu khairan. So the topic of the khutbah was self-accountability. Alhamdulillah, this is a very important topic for our spirituality as well as day-to-day activities. So let's get back to the question that I have for our brother, that self-accountability, when we talk about it. So we have a spiritual self-accountability that we are accountable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, praying salah, we do only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Siyam, we do only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many other dhikr that you have mentioned that we have to remember. And then we have self-accountability for our day-to-day activities. Self-accountability, taking care of our own health. Self-accountability, taking care of our family, right? Self-accountability, our work, our school, our community, as a general entire humanity, because we as a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a mercy when you establish Islam.
Yes.
So how, inshallah, a person can differentiate between these two, self-accountability, and make it such a way that he meets both goals in terms of fulfilling Allah's requirements and fulfilling the requirements for all the makhlukat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for us.
Jazakallah khair. This is a very good question. Jazakallah khair. And may Allah make it easy for me to answer it, because subhanallah, this question is an important question, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the day of judgment, is going to ask us about his rights, and is going to ask us, on the other hand, about his servants' rights upon us. And so this is actually very important question in Islam. So for the first part, I'm going to answer for this first part and second part on how we can, inshallah, get them together. Subhanallah al-Azim, as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created the humankind and the jinn except to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in different surah, وَاعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا, and worship Allah and do not associate anything, any thing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in a lot of places Allah says, when he start talking about the forbidden things, he start with not associating with anything with him, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all the sins except his right, which is he created us for. The purpose that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his servants, he created everybody, is to worship him. So if somebody does not worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they put themselves away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mercy. And so in a hadith, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam have emphasized this, and he have told Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the fruit of La ilaha illallah and the fruit of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not associating any partner with him. One day the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was going with Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Mu'adh ibn Jabal was riding behind him, and he told him, "Atadri ma haqqu al-ibadi 'ala Allah wa ma haqqu Allah 'ala 'ibadi?" He told Mu'adh ibn Jabal, "Oh Mu'adh, do you know what is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon his servants, and what is the right of his servants upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?" He says, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." Mu'adh ibn Jabal is letting us know that if you do not know an answer, we should say, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." Because if we talk and we do not know, that means we are speaking for Allah and we do not know, and this is a great thing. Subhanallah. So Mu'adh ibn Jabal is teaching of this. He says, "Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam." Allah and his messenger knows best. He says, "Haqqu Allahi 'ala 'ibadihi alla yushriku bihi shay'an wa haqqu al-'ibadi 'ala Allah alla yu'adhibuhum." And then Mu'adh ibn Jabal told him, "Afa ubashshiruhum ya Rasulullah?" Qala, "La, fala yattakilu." He says, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was going with Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he says, do you know the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon his servants? And do you know the rights of the servants upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He says, Allah and his Prophet knows best. He says, the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon his servant is that they do not associate any partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the right of the servant upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they sincerely do this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not punish them. And then Mu'adh ibn Jabal was very happy, and he told him, should I gladsize them, should I tell them? He says no, so that they do not lean, so that they do not, subhanallah, have this as the only source of going to Jannah by saying La ilaha illallah, because La ilaha illallah has a concept of action. If we do not have an action to subhanAllah manifest and show this La ilaha illallah in our heart, then it is not sincere. And so that's why the scholars, they always relate the action with La ilaha illallah. And I'm coming to this, is that it's a right upon Allah, upon you, the listener, is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take you to Jannah. And one of the sign of Iman is action. So this is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because we see a lot of people worship a God that they call a God, but if you don't follow the footsteps of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then we are not, subhanallah, meeting the terms of La ilaha illallah, because we always associate La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who shows us what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how he wants us to worship him. And the second question, which is a lot of the time we miss, we think that Islam is only the right of Allah, and we worship Allah and Salah wa Al-Zakah wa Sawm wa Al-Hajj, and that's it. But the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, subhanallah al-azim, exactly this point that I mentioned about Salah, Siyam and Zakah, he told the companions, says, do you know who is bankrupt? Do you know who is broke? Who doesn't have money? Who doesn't have anything? They said, isn't he the one who doesn't have money? And they're looking at it in charge, because he didn't teach them yet. So he told them, Al-Muflis, the bankrupt one, the broke one, is the one who have a lot of prayer, is the one who have a lot of Siyam and Zakah and Hajj, but he eat the money of this, and he kill this, and bought by this, and not give the rights of this, and oppress this person. He comes in the day of judgment with this mountain of good deeds, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives his good deeds to those whom he has oppressed, and he comes bankrupt with no good deeds, because the good deeds are the currency in the day of judgment. They become bankrupt, they don't have anything. From here we see that it's subhanallah a great relationship between the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the right of the servants, because these rights of the servants are, subhanAllah, directly influencing our consequence in the Day of Judgment through how we treat them. And subhanAllah, the summary of the rights of the servants between their each other is mentioned in a hadith, are six. The Prophet ﷺ said, حَقُّ الْمُسْلِمْ عَلَى الْمُسْلِمْ sit. The rights of the Muslim between each other are six. First, when he meets him, they say assalamu alaikum. So making salam is a right for your brother. And we see this sometimes, you know, we go around and we don't say assalamu alaikum, whether it's we forget it or whether we are shy to show our religion between the kuffar. But we should always be proud of that. Second, is that if he seek advice, give him the advice according to what you know from the Quran and from the Sunnah. Third is that if he invite you for a good purpose, subhanAllah, respond to them, except you if you have a necessity not to go. But if he calls you, it's a right upon you to go to their call. And subhanAllah, if he sneezes and he says Alhamdulillah, what you should do is that, subhanAllah, you should say, غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ, may Allah forgive you. غفر الله لنا ولكم هداكم الله وأصلح بالكم. Two narrations. Whether you say غفر الله لنا ولكم, may Allah forgive us and you, or you say هداكم الله وأصلح بالكم, may Allah guide you and make your heart in relaxation and tranquility. Subhanallah al-Azim. And so from this hadith, and it's not only that, but the Prophet is telling us what is very important. And on the other hand, we see that we should not oppress. We should not do bad things toward our brother, toward our sister, because anything that we do is going to be, subhanAllah, accounted in the Day of Judgment. And so when we relate these two, we see they're very, subhanAllah, in a strong relationship, because when we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we fear to disobey Him by oppressing others. We fear to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by oppressing others. And so having a good connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very important. And to summarize this, is that when or the more we do self-accountability, the more we are pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of worshipping Him and in terms of dealing with people the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to deal with people and to worship Him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us.
Jazakallah khair and mashallah. Very good and detailed with examples from hadith. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all self-accountable, as Islam is a complete way of life, a deen, so we are accountable for every action of ours. So, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallahu khairan.